Hi, this is Chris Widener, president of Made for Success, and this is Finding Financial Freedom so that you can ensure a fantastic financial finish. You know, lots of stuff is going on nowadays with money and finances. There's books and tapes and seminars, and it seems like everybody knows about the stock market. And everybody wants to achieve financial freedom. They want to make sure that their financial future is a fantastic one. That's what we're going to cover today, finding financial freedom so that you can ensure a fantastic financial finish. Do you ever get this in your mail? Something that says something like this: find financial freedom. Make $150,000 a year from home. Do you ever get those things? I do. I get them in my email. I get them in the mail. And every time I get one of these, I think to myself, financial freedom. Now, see, I already have financial freedom, even though it doesn't look like what these solicitations promise me. Financial freedom is a buzzword for our generation. It's the pursuit of literally millions of people. So many people are looking to enhance their financial life, and that's good. We ought to improve our financial lives. We ought to grow financially. But unfortunately, I think that many people have a wrong perspective about their financial lives, and they're looking in a direction that will never enable them to have true financial freedom. Even though it's the pursuit of millions of people, I'm not so sure we know what financial freedom is. So what is it? Is financial freedom elusive? Can anybody attain financial freedom? The answer is yes. Let me start by saying that this is not about how to earn money, although a little later on we're going to talk about ways that you can make sure that your finish financially is going to be a fantastic one. Rather, this is going to be about how to find financial freedom, which may or may not involve making more money. Financial freedom, here we come. The first step in finding financial freedom is to realize that financial freedom has absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with how much money you have or how much money you make. Let me say that again, because I think it's important for us to understand that. That is the principle that financial freedom is based upon, and that is that finding financial freedom is realizing that it has absolutely nothing to do whatsoever with how much money you have or how much money you make. Now, I know what you're saying. You're saying to yourself, what? Exactly. That is exactly it. Financial freedom is something that goes on not outside of you. It has nothing to do with how much money you have or how much money you make. Finding financial freedom is something that goes on inside of you. This is why somebody who makes very little can be happy, and someone who makes a ton of money can be extremely stressed out over his or her financial situation. Now, you probably all know somebody who is completely satisfied with their life, even though they don't necessarily make a lot of money. They've got a good family. They've got a good job. They have the kind of money that they need in order to satisfy the kind of life that they want to live, and they seem to be at peace with themselves and with their circumstances and with that which is around them. We all know people like that. Maybe not very many, but we all do know that there are some people who don't make a whole lot of money, but they do have financial freedom. They don't have all the money in the world, but they have financial freedom. And I can't tell you how many people I know, on the other hand, who have all sorts of money but have no financial freedom. In fact, they're in bondage. They're in bondage to debt. They're in bondage to worry. They have no financial freedom. So the fact is that there are people out there who have very little and they're happy, and there's people out there who have a lot and they're not happy. So the first step is to realize that financial freedom is more about our attitudes toward money than about the amount of money we have. You have to grasp that, because if you're going to experience financial freedom, you need to understand that it's an attitude. So you're saying to yourself now, okay, Chris, I'm with you. So what are the attitudes that provide financial freedom? Here are a few of them that help me to experience financial freedom. Number one is that I do not have to worry about money. Have you given yourself permission to not worry about money? You know, I used to catch myself saying, if I had more money, then I wouldn't have to worry about such and such. But do you know what? I don't have to worry anyway. I can control my income. I can control my outgo. I can make choices that can alleviate any of my worries. I also realize that things always work out. So why worry? I choose not to worry. I've given myself the freedom to not have to worry about money. You know, worry, the best definition that I've ever heard of the word worry, is that it's a bad use of the imagination. And so what happens is we're in a situation and we're looking, say, 4 months out, 6 months out, 1 year out, or maybe you're thinking about retirement 10 years out, and we begin to worry. We begin to imagine a situation that hasn't even come true yet. And we begin to imagine that we won't have enough money, that we won't be able to pay the bills and those kinds of things. I've decided that there's nothing I can do about that in the long run, but I can do something about it in the short run. I choose not to worry about it, and I begin to take action over my finances so that day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year, I am developing for myself a fantastic financial finish, which we're going to talk about at the end of this CD. I don't have to worry about money, and neither do you. We can begin to imagine for ourselves a life of abundance, a life where we are taken care of, where our bills are met, and we do have financial freedom. Number two is closely aligned with this, and this is that I can be happy regardless of my financial state. I know people who are worth millions of dollars, and I know people who don't have two nickels to rub together. Some are happy and some aren't. And none of the people who have a lot of money have ever said to me, "Chris, I've become so happy since I got money." You see, those people were happy before they had money, and now they're happy now that they have money. But there's so many of us out there that think that if only we had more money, then we'd be happier. Money does not equate itself to happiness. If you're going to find financial freedom, you need to understand this, because you might end up getting a bunch of money and find out that it hasn't made you happy, and that's not freedom. We can be happy regardless of our financial state. The happiness of the people who have money has nothing to do with the money. In fact, I think it was the billionaire David Geffen who said, "Anyone who says that money will buy them happiness has never had any money." That's coming from the voice of experience, because he has a lot of money and he understands that your happiness has more to do with the kind of relationships you have and the kind of life that you lead, the way that you handle yourself. That's what happiness comes from. Financial freedom does not come from having a super strong financial bottom line. Happiness comes from the kind of life you live. The third point is that money will be a means to an end, not the end itself. Oftentimes, our financial goals are about the amount of money that we have. I want to let you in on a secret. My wife and I have one financial goal in our life. We have never sat down and figured out how much money we want to have at the end of life. We've never sat down and decided what would be the optimum income that we want to make. We've never set any of those kinds of goals. We have one financial goal in our life, and that is, by the end of our life, we have a goal about how much money we want to give away to make a difference in the world around us. You see, that way, money is not the end. Money becomes the means to an end. Another way to look at it is that money will be a tool to build the house, not the house itself. You see, if you want to cultivate strong relationships with your grown children, you don't look at money as your source of happiness. You say to yourself, the money that I have will enable me to take my kids and my grandkids on a trip. And that then builds relationships, and it builds memories, and it builds a legacy. The money was not the end, but it was the means to the end. I would set some financial goals if I were you, but go beyond that to know what greater purpose there will be when you reach them. What will be the house that you will build with the tool, with your money? Money will be a means to an end, but it's not the end in itself. Because if you make money the end in and of itself, you'll never experience financial freedom. Because money is never enough for you if you're looking for money. Rockefeller, when he was asked how much money is enough money, he said, just a little bit more. It's never enough, and it's never the end goal. The fourth principle is that I am free. We need to understand that we are free people. I'm free to earn. Some people think it's bad to earn more money. In fact, even some people who earn a lot of money, who pursue earning a lot of money, they feel guilty about it because they're earning a lot of money. But we're free. We're free to earn money. Some people think it's bad to earn money, but it isn't. I'm free to save. Some people believe that it's bad to save. In fact, a while back, there was a couple of books that were written. One was Die Rich. And that was about how when you die, you should be able to leave all sorts of money to your inheritors. And the other book that came out shortly thereafter was called Die Broke and Why You Should Spend All the Money That You Have. But we're free to save, too. Some people believe that it's bad to save. It isn't. I'm free to give money away. Some people feel that they'll be better off hoarding it. In fact, I find a lot of people that say, well, when I have a big stash, then I'll give money away. But I've found that it's best to continually be giving money away to charity and to groups and to people who are making a difference in the world around them. I'm free to earn, I'm free to save, and I'm free to give money away. And here's one for you, I'm free to spend. Some people believe that they can't spend anything on themselves. Other people, unfortunately, spend way too much on themselves and they end up in debt. That's coming up in a little bit. But some people believe that they can't spend anything on themselves. The fact is, you can. We're free to make choices. That's financial freedom. One of my favorite quotes is from Charles Wesley. He says, earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can. Let me say that to you one more time. Earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can. If you think about that, it's the perfect way to express that tension that is in our financial life that enables us to experience financial freedom. If you earn all you can, then you're not in financial freedom because you're just always trying to earn more money. That is, if you only earn all you can. If you only save all you can, then you become one who's always looking at the bottom line and can't enjoy other things. Give all you can. If that's all you're doing, you're going to end up broke. You want to earn money and save money and invest money so that you can give. So that's the perfect tension. Earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can. That will keep you in financial freedom. Here's some other principles for financial freedom. We need to realize that debt is the primary freedom killer. Do you want financial freedom? Then the first thing you should do is get out of debt. That is priority number one. Before you do anything else, before you go to look for a raise, before you go to look to invest, the best thing you can do is get rid of your debt. You know, a lot of times people say, well, I'm going to start investing or I'm going to start saving and make, you know, 7 or 8% or 12 or 14%. Well, you know, if you pay off your credit cards, you're going to be making 20% a year, guaranteed. You put the money in the stock market, it might go up, might go down. You pay off your debt, you're making 20% a year, sometimes even more than that. Getting rid of debt is priority number one. One of the reasons I have financial freedom is that I have no debt other than my house payment. And I work hard to manage myself and to manage our home to keep us that way. You know, for years, I drove an old junker car. And while I may have looked bad, I had financial freedom that others who were in debt didn't have. I had a friend once who had quite a bit of money, and he drove an old junker car. He lived in a big house, but he drove an old junker car. It was a way for him to remind himself that oftentimes cars are just big debt piles. It's interesting. I've also found in my life that many of the people who have gotten to a lot of money drive the most basic cars. It's usually the people who want to impress people who are driving the big fancy cars. And then the people who've earned a lot of money and have a lot of money, very often they're driving normal cars because it was driving normal cars that got them to the point where they had a lot of money. Another principle is to embrace delayed gratification. Here's the principle. Buy it now and you'll struggle later. But here's the opposite. Delay it now, invest the money, and you can have all you want later on. You can buy something now and spend the money, and that money is gone. and you can have that thing one time. If you delay your gratification and you take that money and you invest it, over time as that investment grows, at the end or later on down your life, you'll be able to buy four or five of those things and still have the money left over. I'll tell you what we did. We did a remodel on our house, and we had a certain amount of money set aside, and I said to my wife, I said, you know, we could do this all in like 1 month, get it all done, spend the money, and then that money would be gone. Now, of course, it's a long-term investment because it's in our house, but here's what I said. Why don't we instead invest our money and build out the rest of the house and do the remodeling as that money grows? So in the end, here's what happened. In the end, we had paid completely for our remodel, and we had that amount of money still sitting there in our investments. We paid for it with the growth. We embraced delayed gratification. Yeah, there were times we looked around and said, boy, it would be nice to have this nicer right now, and we have the money to do it. Why not do it? We were delaying gratification, and in the end, we're better off. The last one is to have more by managing better. The fact is that most of us earn enough. What would be beneficial would be to set our priorities and live by a budget. As we get control of our financial life, our budget will loosen up a bit and we'll find ourselves enjoying it more. Money that is already there can be your answer if you put it to work for you. One of the things that I found as I've dealt with people is that they go back and they start looking at the budget, and all of a sudden they realize that they're spending $150 a month on coffee and lattes, or they're spending $200 a month on going out to dinner. I knew one couple that when they finally looked at it, they were struggling financially and wondering where it was going. They found out they were spending a couple $100 a month just on buying wine to drink with dinner every night. Have you ever looked and seen how you can manage your finances better and find what many people have called the hidden money? It's not really hidden at all. It's just money that's being spent by undisciplined spending. If you manage your finances better, you'll be able to loosen that budget up a little bit, and you'll be able to take that money and invest it and work toward securing a fantastic financial finish. I want to encourage you to spend some time thinking through your attitudes about money. Oftentimes we think about how-tos of how to invest and how to grow our money, but have you ever spent some time thinking through your attitudes about money? What do you think about money? Do you think that it's good? Do you think that it's bad? Do you think that it will create for you happiness? What are your attitudes about money? You may be surprised at how you can change a few of those attitudes, look at things a little bit differently, and begin to enjoy true financial freedom. I talked at the beginning about giving you some principles to ensure a fantastic financial finish. Retirement is a big thing that many people look forward to, and it's something that they want to be prepared for. Most people want to get to the end of their lives and to be able to live comfortably, to take care of themselves and to leave something behind for their children. And these are admirable goals and very achievable, especially if you have a good plan. Now, while I'm going to be very specific here that I am not giving financial advice, these are the principles I live by, and I believe that they can bring anyone to a fantastic financial finish. But as always, you should check with your financial consultant before taking any action whatsoever. I think everybody ought to have a person who they are working with, whether it's an accountant or a financial advisor or a stockbroker, someone who knows what they're doing, who can help you understand your goals, prioritize, and then execute. So here's some principles that I live by, and it's been successful for me so far, and I believe it's going to ensure me a fantastic financial finish. The first one is to be aggressive in the beginning and conservative in the end. The way finances work long-term is that you want to maximize your returns while you're young, while tolerating more risk, because over the long-term, you will recoup any losses you may incur because of the risk. This is why when you're young, you can be more aggressive. You have more time to let your returns accumulate. And if you happen to have a bad year 1 year because your aggressive investments went down a little bit because of a change in the economy, that's fine, because you still have 30 years to make those things back up. So you want to get as much out of your investments as possible early on in life. You want to be aggressive in the beginning and conservative in the end. The older you get, the more you want to be transitioning more into conservative, what they call capital protecting investments. This way, short-term market fluctuations won't affect your day-to-day living situation. I personally, at my age in the mid-30s, I have my investments in very aggressive stocks and mutual funds. I may be down 10% one year, but up 80% the next. And over time, the investment makes more gains than losses. See, I have 30 years before I need to get more conservative. And as I get older, I will shift into stocks and mutual funds and other investment vehicles that may only give me 7 to 20% a year, but will ensure me of less risk when I can't afford that risk. This idea lets me get as much as I can while I'm young and I can afford the risk so that when I'm old, I can draw a lower percentage off of a bigger net dollar amount. Very important. Be aggressive in the beginning, conservative in the end, and you need to go to your financial advisor and talk to them about those specific things. Another one is to use insurance. Now, I'm not an insurance salesman, but I could be. When my dad died, I was 4 years old, and he was making about $89,000 a year in 1970. That's pretty good money back then. In fact, that's pretty good money right now. He was making about $89,000 a year, and he had $30,000 worth of life insurance. That's not very good. For a very nominal fee, he could have protected his family and left them with a couple of million dollars to maintain their current lifestyle. For many, you'll want insurance to protect your assets that you'll be passing on to your loved ones. Don't let the government get too much. They'll take as much as they can, but with the right kind of planning, you can make sure, through proper use of insurance, to make sure that your inheritors get as much as they possibly can. Find a good insurance agent and they'll help you out. Also, make sure that you have all the right kinds of insurance: life insurance, health insurance, disability insurance, etc. All of these tragedies can drain your long-term financial health. And so you want to be smart, you want to be wise, and use insurance to protect yourself, to hedge against those kinds of things that can happen, and to limit your risk and the downside there. The third one that I would encourage you to do is, when investing in stocks, is to use a broker. The brokerage business is going through a radical transition with the onset of the internet, and that's good, actually. It'll make those brokers sharpen up a bit, it'll make them drop their fees, and it'll make them offer more in return. For a while, I was anti-broker, but now I guess I've come full circle, and I've realized that it's good to have somebody watching your investments for you. Just be sure to tell them that you want them to be proactive with your account and you want them to communicate with you regularly. This way, you get the benefit of their expertise. They're the professionals. They're the ones who are devoting 8-10 hours a day to understanding and to learning. You have other things you need to do. You want somebody on your side who knows what they're doing, who can help you toward that fantastic financial finish. If you want to keep an online brokerage and trade stocks, that's okay. I do it myself. Give yourself a little to play with and leave the rest to the professionals. Number four is to start early. Even if you can only put $10 a month away, do it. The law of compounding interest is simply amazing. If you put it away early on, at least you give yourself something that's growing. And if you have kids, consider giving them a head start by putting something away for them. The 20 years that it grows before they take it over will mean a lot to them in the long run. You know, there's a rule called the rule of 72, and that means that you divide the amount of interest that you're earning every year into 72, and that's how often your money will double. If you have $10,000 and you make 24% a year, that means your money will double every 3 years, because 24 goes into 72 three times. The rule of 72, the more time you give yourself to earn that interest and to move into that 72, the more apt you are to have a better financial finish. The fifth one is to be disciplined. Now, this is where most people break down. I said earlier that most people make enough money, and it's true. The problem is that the money they make is spent immediately. But those who are disciplined, who achieve long-term financial stability and abundance, are the people who have disciplined themselves to spend less and to save more, to invest wisely. There are primarily two ways to be disciplined if you want to have a fantastic financial finish. Number one is disciplined in controlling your spending. And number two, disciplined in your saving or investing. This means that you commit to spending less than you earn. Add it all up. Are you spending less than you earn? Or are you going deeper and deeper into debt? Also, are you putting something away each month? You may think that you don't have enough to put away, but even if you can only put away $10 a month, you should be saving and investing. And over the long haul, that discipline is going to create for you an abundance at the end of your life. I have a little equation that I use in my time management seminar, and it's called a little equation that produces big results. And it says that your short-term tasks multiplied by time equals your long-term accomplishments. So your short-term investments multiplied by time will become your long-term financial finish. The next one is to stay out of debt. We talked a little bit about that earlier. I want to hit it again because it is so important. If there's one thing I could encourage you to do, it's to get out of debt. It's to wipe debt out. It's to make your number one goal to get out of debt. Don't buy anything new until that debt is gone. And that'll be the best investment that you can make right now. Debt is an absolute killer. It'll kill your future, it'll kill your balance sheet, and it will kill your emotional health. If you can live absolutely debt-free, I'd advise it. Most people should have only a house debt. I know that in this day and age when houses have increased so much that many people, they have to have a house debt. In fact, it was interesting. I was talking to my father-in-law, and we were talking about the price of houses and how they've gone up. His father, when he bought a house, the house was worth about half of what he made in a year. When my father-in-law bought his house was worth about what he made in a year. So it was about the 1-to-1 ratio. And when we bought our house was about 5 times what we made in a year. So houses are going out. They're more of an investment. The price of them is growing. And so if you have to have a debt, make it your house debt, because it is essentially an investment and something that most people simply can't afford to pay all cash for. You might say, if I only have a debt on my house, you might say, but I wouldn't have the car I want. Well, the question I would ask is, do you want one of the cars you want now with a debt coming due every 30 days and causing you pressure? Or would you like to buy any car or two or three that you want later on out of the interest your investments are throwing off and pay all cash with no debt? That's the way I want to live. I want to be able to have no debt, to have the money I need so that I can pay for things when I need them. I heard a story of my wife's grandfather who never had a credit card. And all of a sudden, a number of years ago, he got a credit card, but he never used it, and he kept it in his wallet. And one day he was out on the road and he blew a tire on his car, and he had to go in to get a tire done, and he had no cash on him. So he used his credit card and he paid for this tire. And he felt so terrible, he went right home and he cut it up because now he had a debt and he had tried to live debt-free up until that point. The next one is another one that we've talked about, and I want to just say it again, delay gratification. This is the key to staying out of debt and to accumulating what you'll need later on to maintain the lifestyle you desire. You've heard the old saying that a penny saved is a penny earned. Well, the truth is that a penny saved and invested for a number of years is more like 10 pennies earned. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't mean to live life as a pauper, and we ought to enjoy things. In fact, when I get a big check or I get extra income, I give 10% away to charity, and I take 10% for things that my family and I would like. In other words, we splurge with it. We go out and we do something fun with it so that we can feel like we're enjoying it. We're not living life like paupers. And the rest, we save and we invest. This allows us to have some extras, but causes us to delay gratification that we could otherwise have if we would have spent that extra money. In the end, I'll be glad that I invested that money. And the last one is to read up. I would encourage you to learn about money and about how it works. In fact, a great book that I would recommend to you, it's a current bestseller called Rich Dad, Poor Dad, What I Learned from My Rich Dad. It's a story of a guy who writes the book, and he talks about his real dad who did not have much money and the lessons he learned from him, which did not allow him to accumulate financial freedom and a financial success in terms of his finish. And then what he learned from his best friend's dad, who was a rich dad, who taught him how to earn money and make money and save money. I'd encourage you to learn more about money and how it works. Even if it doesn't particularly interest you, you need to know how it works in order to manage your affairs. Let's face it, everybody has to deal with money. Money is a factor in every day of our life. We have to buy things, we have to pay rent, we have to spend it on groceries. We have to be able to deal with money, and we need to know how it works. Know the basics of saving, investing, interest rates, stocks, mutual funds, and the power of compound interest. If I had to pick a beginner magazine that is well written and very good information, I'd suggest to you the Wall Street Journal magazine called Smart Money. Pick one up at the newsstand, and then you can pull the little tear-out cards in there, and you can subscribe from there. But it is an excellent magazine that'll give you a broad base of understanding of the financial world that you need to know. They have lots of excellent articles, and they're written in a way that will help you understand those things. In closing, let me say that I think anyone can have a fantastic financial finish. Let me say it again. Anybody can have a fantastic financial finish. I'm always reminded of a guy that I read about, probably about 10 years ago. He died when he was about 70. He worked for United Parcel Service his whole life, and he never made more than $14,000 a year. He was a single guy, never got married, never had kids, but he never made more than $14,000 a year. And when he died, he left an estate to, I think it was three colleges in the state of Florida, of $70 million. Anybody can have a fantastic financial finish if they apply themselves in the right way. It's simply a matter of applying the principles over the long term and watching your money grow. Every now and then you read an article about somebody who never made more than X amount of money and yet they left an estate of millions. Get behind the scenes and you find that they saved, they invested, and they watched their spending. Here's to your fantastic financial finish. This is Chris Widener again, and I'm glad that you joined me here today to see how you can have a fantastic financial finish and how you can achieve financial freedom. I hope that after listening to this, you understand that your freedom has nothing to do with how much money you have, that you can experience happiness regardless of your financial situation, but that we need to be wise and we need to be good stewards and we need to invest and learn and grow so that when it comes to the end of our life, we are in a great situation, a fantastic financial situation. If there's any way that we can help you from here on out, please don't hesitate to contact us. Our website is www.madeforsuccess.com, and you can email me anytime at Chris, that's C-H-R-I-S, at madeforsuccess.com. Here's to your financial freedom and to your fantastic financial finish. Until the next time, remember, you were made for success.